As I've already mentioned, that this Sunday is the last Sunday in our study of 1 Timothy. And this has been a good book. It's been we've been talking about getting the most out of church. And, you know, Paul is writing to a younger pastor, you know, to Timothy. Timothy is his son in the faith. It appears that either he led him to the Lord or he nurtured him along from a young man. And Paul is no longer pastoring at Ephesus. He spent more at Ephesus time there as in ministry than perhaps any of his other stops. But he's handed it off to Timothy. Timothy's a young, shy kind of guy. He's a little timid. He's sickly. And he's got a congregation where he's got to fill the shoes of the great Apostle Paul. And Paul is writing him back saying, listen, you're the man for the job, and I want to just encourage you. And I, as we've been looking at this whole book of Timothy, we come down to this final section, and we're left with three really important thoughts. To get the most out of church, it involves three really important things. The first thing that it requires, it involves, is a man of God. A man of God, now this term is one of my favorite terms in the Bible. The word man of God is used over 80 times in the Bible. And that's in the New International Version. If you use a different version, they might put it in there more or less, because some expressions, they just translate a little differently. But just over 80, I think like 83 times the New International Version of the Bible. And it's used for people like Moses. Moses was a man of God. It's used for a guy like Samuel. Samuel was a man of God. Elijah was a man of God. David was a man of God. And the prophets were, a lot of them were called a man of God, a man of God. Moses is an interesting character because Moses, all of these people seem to have had this one feature that was really prominent in Moses. Moses, the man of God, went right into the presence of God. He went up on the mountain, remember that? And he met face to face with God. And when he came down, he was glowing. He was glowing. He was radiating because God is light. And he's radiating that light so that he had to cover his face because the people were afraid of him because he was glowing. And the idea of a man of God, and I would say also a woman of God, is that they spend time with God. They go into the presence of God. They go into the presence of his word, they hear him speak. They go into the presence of God and they in prayer and they speak to God. They're in the presence of God where they meditate on the things that God says and they have this intimate relationship with God. Now, that's not to say that the man of God is perfect. He's far from perfect. If you recall, Moses was a murderer, right? That's a little less than perfect. Samuel was not even a good dad. He was not a good family man. His children were terrible. They were committing adultery inside the temple. That'd be like doing it at church. And he had bad kids. He was not a good dad. Elijah ran like crazy from Jezebel because she threatened him. So it's not that these people are perfect. The thing that makes them a man or a person, a woman of God, is that they spend time with God, in the presence of God, in the Word of God, in prayer with God, and in spite of their flaws, like even David, King David, a man after God's own heart, is a man who also committed adultery and had all kinds of problems in his family. But yet he is a man of God. You see, you don't have to be perfect. You just have to go into the presence of God and spend some time there. He writes to Timothy, and Timothy is called a man of God, but you, man of God. I don't think if there's a better thing he could have said about Timothy than that. He says, flee from all of this. You know, sometimes it's a good thing to flee. Sometimes it's a bad thing. But sometimes it's a good thing. He says, flee from all of this. Now, all of this was the stuff in the previous chapter. Remember, he was, in the previous verses, he was saying that you are not to be after money. You're not to be a charlatan. You're supposed to not have the love of money at the core of who you are, so that you are trying to do church work to make the buck. And so he says, that's what you have to flee. On the other side, but you, man of God, flee all of this, but also pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Righteousness, doing what is right. That's all it is. Instead of going for the money, you just do what is right, no matter what. Godliness, you do what God would do. You ask yourself, what would Jesus do in this circumstance? Faith, you trust God. Love. Now, love means that you will sacrifice yourself for the best interest of someone else. Endurance is that you hang in there to the very end. Gentleness is the word meekness. Remember meek Jesus? Meek Jesus? You know, some people think that meekness is a weak quality. Because, Jesus was meek. They said, well, he was a sissy. Not really. Jesus was actually meek when he got angry, made a whip, went into the temple, overthrew the money changers' tables, drove out all the animals, and he said, the zeal of the Lord hath eaten me up. This was meek Jesus. You see, our understanding of meek and the Bible's understanding of meek are two different things. The word meek means to be a perfect gentleman. It means you know when to get angry, and you know when to control your anger emotion. You know how to use your emotions in the right way. That's a meek man. Jesus, at one point, it says he gave them an angry look. I know what that look is like. When I misbehaved in church, there were five of us kids. I was the last one on the row. My parent would look over and just give me the angry look. Do you know what I'm talking about? The angry look, so that was, you're going to get it as soon as this service is over. I got that one down too, because, you know, every now and then I'd be up in the pulpit and my kids would be misbehaving and I kind of have to stop and give them the angry look and they'd shape right up, all right? So one time my son kind of got away from my wife, my first wife, and he kind of scooted down the aisle, but there were a few aisles back. So she scooted down to get him, and he cut across this way. She scooted back this way. He cut across. You know, the whole congregation was watching them, was not listening to me, all right? A friend of mine, he said he had a similar thing like that happen, and then finally the parent caught the kid and threw the kid over the shoulder and was going out the doors, and as they were going out, the little child cried out to everyone, "Pray for me!" Yeah, that kid was hoping to get grandma's paddle. My mom was a grandma, and she had a paddle on the wall, and it was a long stick, and then it had a pillow on the end. Yeah, not likely that child was going to get grandma's pillow. You know what? Gentleness, meekness, is knowing when to be angry and when not to be angry, knowing how to use your anger. My dad was a meek man. That's not to say, man, when my dad gave you a licking, you knew you had a licking. But my dad would say this, go downstairs and wait for me. You know what? It was twofold. The fear of him coming down was greater than the paddling. But it was also the cooling down time where he would say, you know what? I'm not going to discipline out of anger. I'm going to discipline for correction. You see? You see what's going on there? It's the perfect gentleman. And that's what he's saying. In the ministry, because people can be annoying. You ever notice that? One pastor said, you know, this would be a great job if it weren't for the people. Well, that's pretty impossible. You see, he said, Timothy, you've got to have gentleness. You've got to know what are the issues, okay? And the ones that are worthy of bringing discipline in the church and those that you just got to nurture. You've got to know how to handle it. You've got to be gentle. You've got to be gentle. So that the next one is that you have to know when to fight. Got to know when to fight. I think it was Kenny Rogers said, you got to know when to hold them. You got to know when to fold them. You got to know when to walk away. You got to know when to run. All right. And you also got to know when to fight. You got to know when to fight. He says, fight the good fight of faith. He's saying, in all your meekness, he's saying, no, be like Jesus. Jesus gave us an example of how you fight. Jesus fought the devil with the word of God. He quoted the scripture every time. Every time Satan came to him, he quotes the scriptures. It stands written, it stands written, it stands written in the word of God. He knows how to fight. When it comes to other adversaries in your life, sometimes we just love them to death. And that can be more annoying to them that you love your enemy than if you're hostile towards your enemy. You've got to fight the good fight. You fight in a good way. All right? And so we're going to advance to the next slide. All right? He says, take hold. Take hold. I find this passage very fascinating. It says, fight the good fight of faith and take hold of eternal life. Listen, you already have it. If you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, Timothy had. He already had the gift of eternal life. So what in the world is he saying? Take hold of eternal life. You see, it says, he that has the Son hath life. He has passed over from death unto life. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but has everlasting life. The moment you accept Jesus, you have it. And here he says, take hold of eternal life. What's going on here? Does he have it or doesn't he have it? Well, of course he has it. But he's saying, what you have, you take hold of. Make it a reality. Make this work in your life. Make it effective. He says, take hold of that to which you were called. He says, to which you were called when you made your good confession of faith in the presence of many witnesses. Obviously, Timothy had made a good confession that, like Peter, he said, that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. He had done that in the presence of many witnesses, and he had been called to that. He says, also, he says, in the sight of God, who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate, made a good confession. Notice good confession. Good confession. He's saying, Timothy, you've got a good confession just like Jesus had. What was Jesus' good confession? Well, if you go to the Gospels, you'd find in the Gospels that Jesus was before Pilate. And Pilate was asking him, you know, he's saying, are you the king of the Jews? He says to him, did you come to that conclusion or did somebody tell you? And he said, oh, then you are saying that you are king of the Jews. And he says, it's just as you say. It was to this end that I was born. Knowing, he's confessing who he is, that he is the Christ, he is the King of kings, Lord of lords. And he's standing there before Pilate, and Pilate doesn't know what to do with this man. Jesus had a great confession. He's saying, Timothy, you've made a great confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, just like Peter did. And just as Jesus himself said before Pontius Pilate, even though he had been beaten and knew there was more severity yet to come, he made that good confession. You take hold on eternal life by staying true to what you believe. He says, I charge you to keep this command without spot and blameless until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. I got a safe there. Take my word and put it in the safe. Lock it up. I mean, the safe is inside you. You receive the word of God. You lock it up. You treasure it. And you only have to do it. It's temporary. Listen, it's temporary. It's until our Lord Jesus Christ returns. At that time, we will be glorified. I will be glorified like the Lord Jesus Christ himself. I'll have a new body. And in my new body, the greatest thing I think about heaven, the greatest thing, it is not the streets of gold, the pearly gates, the walls of jasper, and all the beautiful places that it's going to be. You can read the description in the Revelation. The greatest thing about heaven is that I'll never sin. Think about that for a moment. I'm never going to have to say I'm sorry. I'm never going to have to apologize. I'm never going to have to say to somebody, oh, yeah, you're right, I'm wrong. Oh, finally. I will not have a sinful nature. I will always do what is right. He's saying, you need to hang on to this until the coming of the Lord, because when the Lord appears, he's going to gather us to him. The word appearing here is the word epiphany. There was a first epiphany of Christ. It's when he came at, we celebrate Christmas, the epiphany of Christ. He came the first time, and he came the first time to be the Lamb of God, slain for our sins. He appears the second time. The second epiphany is going to be to gather the church out of this world, so that we go to be with Christ forever. He's coming back again. And he's saying here, listen, Jesus is coming back again. We'll find that it says at this point, which God will bring about at his time. Listen, I don't know when Jesus is coming back. You don't know when Jesus is coming back. The most I know is that it is imminent. It could happen at any moment. There's no prophecies that have to be fulfilled before he would return. So he could return today. Jesus could return today. He says, which God will bring about at his time. And he says, oh, since I brought up God, to get the most out of the church, the man of God really needs to know God. God, the blessed and only ruler. The only ruler. He is the most high God. That's what Daniel calls him. There is no one higher than he is. There is no there's no pantheon of gods. There's no hierarchy of gods. There is one God. He is the ruler of all. And then he says he is King of kings and Lord of lords. Notice what it says there. Who is? God is. If you were to flip to the book of Revelation, and I think chapter 14, also chapter 19, you would find that Jesus Christ is called King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This verse is telling you that Jesus Christ is God. It's just tucked away in there. It's just placed within in the scripture there. They say, God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus is God. Now notice what it says next. Who alone is immortal, who cannot die. Mortality means I'm subject to death. God cannot die. But wait a minute. Jesus is God. Did not Jesus die? Well, then Jesus is joined a divine nature and a human nature, so that Jesus is the God-man. And so that God became man in Jesus. So that when Jesus died, the human Jesus, the man Jesus, God experienced what man happened to man, although God never died. He's immortal. God cannot die. It's like God cannot be tempted. There's things that God cannot do because they would contradict who he is. He can't cease to be because he's eternal. He cannot sin because he is holy. He is immortal. And he goes on and he says, who lives in an unapproachable light. He radiates with glory, so that when Moses was in his presence, his face caught the glory, and he went down from the mountain and he was beaming the glory of God. Daniel chapter 9 says, in a resurrection state, they that be wise shall shine like the firmament of the heaven. They're going to shine with the brightness of the morning sun. You know how you're going to know in the millennium, those who are the those who have resurrected bodies and those who have normal bodies in the age to come, is those that have resurrected bodies are going to glow. We're going to glow with the brightness of the firmament forever. We're going to have this glow. He says, God lives in an unapproachable light. That's why John says God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. There's a theology here. He says, whom no one has ever seen, God is invisible. You can't see God. You can't see him. From time to time, God took on an appearance. They're called theophanies. That's what theologians call them. In order to communicate with man, he'd come down like in a burning bush, and God was in the bush, and the bush was flame of fire. That was a theophany. God was making a physical manifestation of himself as fire. We find in certain places men occur, appear, and they're called the Lord, or they're called Jehovah, or they're called God, and they're men, and sometimes they're called the angel of the Lord. He's a special designated angel of the Lord. It's a theophany. So that God could actually converse with Abraham about Sodom, he came down with two other angels, and he conversed, and it was the angel of the Lord, and he's called the Lord. The Lord. He's Jehovah. He's God. Because God is invisible. You can't see him. He'll have to take on an appearance. And the only God that we're ever going to really see is Jesus in his body. One day, when we go to heaven, we're going to see Jesus in a body. And Jesus said, to see me is to have seen the Father. Because that's all you're going to see. You won't see the Holy Spirit because he's spirit. He's invisible. You won't see God the Father. He's spirit. He's invisible. And they're all three one and the same God. And the one invisible part, the Logos of Jesus, is in a body. And that's how we're going to approach God, through Jesus Christ, for all eternity, in a body, in a body, in a body. Not only does the church involve a man of God, you need a man of God in the church. But you also need church members. Now, I have up here the membership application for the church. Our process is very simple. If you're interested in being a member, you just fill out this little application. The application then is reviewed by the deacons, and the deacons then make a recommendation to the council, and you're voted, and you're brought into the fellowship of the church. I'll tell you what, it's been the same similar situation every church I've been in, and I have never, ever, in all my years of pastoring, been quite a few, found anybody who was told they couldn't be a part of the church. A part of our application is you give your testimony of how you came to Jesus. And it doesn't have to be all that complicated. We have children fill it out, and they hit the nail right on the head. I believe in Jesus as my Savior. And that's it. I accepted Christ as my Savior. That's it. It's pretty simple. Of course, we're a Baptist church, and so we require that you be baptized and you join the church. And so, but it's very simple. In fact, there's some applications out on the table. You can pick up one today if you'd like to be a member of our church. It says, the thing about the church is the church accumulates wealth. You have wealth. He says, command those who are rich in this present world. You are rich in this present world. In fact, I've been in third world countries, and some of you have been too. I can remember my first time in a third world country. I came back to America. I literally got out of the plane. I got down on the ground, kissed the ground. I love America. We are so wealthy. My son, as a paper boy, made more than the pastor of the church that I attended in the Philippines. My son made more on his paper out in a month than he did for a monthly salary. You tell me we are not rich. We are wealthy in America. We spend more on air conditioning, heating and cooling, than some churches run on for a whole year in a third world country. It's amazing. He says, you are rich. Not only should we accumulate, we have accumulated this wealth, but he says, do not put your hope there. He says, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant. Don't be proud that we're so good in America and we got it so great. Nor to put your hope in your wealth, which is so uncertain. You've watched the stock market fall a few years ago. We noticed half of our portfolio collapsed. I was listening to an expert this week on the radio as I was driving in, and he's predicting the market is a little blown high right now, and it'll probably have a correction up to 20% drop. No, he's not saying it will be 20%, but he's saying the market always has corrections. It gets ahead of itself, and then it drops. It says, listen, it is so uncertain. What you have is so uncertain. But he goes on in this passage. He says, but instead of putting your hope in what you have, you put your hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. You know, God wants you to be happy. Did you know? God wants you to enjoy life. God wants you to be blessed. In the book of Genesis, when God created man, he gets all done, and he says, and he blessed them. God created you to bless you and for you to enjoy life. So God is not withholding anything from me. The stuff that I have, I am to enjoy. And at the same time, I am to reach out and help other people. It says, command them to do good and to be good in good deeds. Now, we've told the Good Samaritan story here several times, but the Good Samaritan is like the epitome of what it is to do good deeds. Good deeds that are done to people you just randomly run into, not because you're going to get anything back. You're just going to minister to them. In fact, he goes on and says, you do this generously. He says, be generous and willing to share. God's given you everything you have to enjoy, and part of that enjoyment, you're supposed to get a thrill out of sharing what you have with other people. If you're stingy, you're not enjoying life. Because one of the greatest joys in life is that blessing, that thrill that comes from helping someone else. I love the missions outreaches of this church, from Open Door to all of it that we do. We're reaching out and touching people's lives. We're sharing generously. He says, in this way, they lay up treasures for themselves and a firm foundation for the coming age. We lay up treasure in heaven, not for the now, but for the future. When I start touching, I'm generous with what I have, and I am giving. And you can do this in several ways. You can give to people in need. You can give to the church. And the church gives to those who are in need. We do. We made it easy for you. You can do it electronically. You can do it on your cell phone. You can do it through an app. You can do it through texting. You can do it on our website. So you got multiple ways you can give, even when you're not here. You can do it the old-fashioned way. You can write a check and put it in the offering. Or you can do it the really old-fashioned way and just put cash in. But you can be. We are the wealthiest nation on the earth. Jesus said, "You lay up yourselves treasures in heaven." I'm sure you've heard the story about the guy who, when it came time to die, and the angel came to him and said, "Okay, it's your time." He said, "Oh, wait, I want to take something with me." He said, "What do you want to take with you? You got everything you could possibly need in heaven." He said, "No, no." He said, "Man, I've accumulated so much. I'd like to take something with me." He says, "Okay, you can take one suitcase with you." So he goes and he loads it with gold bricks. And he loads that thing. He can barely pick it up, but the angel's much stronger. Takes him to heaven. He gets there, and before, as they get to the gate, and he says, "Hey," he said, "What?" He said, "Oh, yeah, he wanted to bring something with him. I said he could bring one suitcase." And so he said, "Okay, open it up. We want to see what was so valuable to you." He opens it up, and they look at it, and they all start laughing at him. He said, "You got to be kidding me. You brought gold?" He said, "Gold is like dirt here. We line the streets with it." You see, what is so valuable here is not valuable there. But when I invest it here, okay, I lay up treasure over there. I do. We lay up treasure. He says, take hold. He says, in this way, they will lay treasure up for themselves, a firm foundation coming age, and they'll take hold of life that is truly life. Jesus called it the abundant life. You will live life to the full. The final area he looks at, you need a man of God, you need a church membership, and you need sons in the faith. He says, Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to you. Timothy is his son. He's saying, I want you not only to flee and pursue, but now you've got to guard. He is his son in the faith. We have to have the younger generation to pass the faith on to so that they guard it for the next generation. I think if the Apostle Paul were around today, he'd be telling us we need to focus a little more on the millennial generation. You know, it's always been this way, that the church is just one generation from extinction. If we don't pass it on to the next generation, there will be no church tomorrow. You guard it. He says, turn away from godless chatter and opposing ideas, what are falsely called knowledge. Actually, the text says science. At one time, theology was the queen of all the sciences. Today, it's like the bottom of the totem pole. What? You're a theologian? What's wrong with you? One time, it was the queen of all the sciences. He says, which some have professed in the faith, and doing so, have wandered from the faith. Grace be with you. He says, watch out. You want to guard what you've been taught so that you don't wander from the faith. I passed on to our task force and to the council and different people an article about the millennial generation. 6 out of 10 of the millennial, that's people 35 down to 15 years old, 6 out of 10 that were raised in the church no longer go to church. They have wandered from the faith. He's saying, we somehow got to get them to guard the faith. We got to get them back into the fold. We got to guard the faith. We got to get them back in. He's saying, stay true. Stay true. Don't wander. I want to sum this all up. To get the most out of church, Bethany needs to, first of all, have a man of God. A man of God to lead. Next, they need a faithful people who will follow. And then finally, they need a younger generation like Timothy to pass it on to. And that's where we're at today. I think Bethany Church is poised to be a church where you will get the most out of your experience here. But we do that all together. And the focal point will be reaching that next generation. And as we do so, we will see God just bless this church. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're thankful for this book. And we're thankful, Lord, for the instruction that we have from the Apostle Paul. And we know that it is the Word of God. And we can get the most out of church. Having men and women of God arise within the church, and a church that is committed to the principles of your Word, and reaching down to the next generation so that we guard the faith, we stay true to the faith, and we pass on the faith. Lord, help us, enable us to do that. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. From this place, we will be a light unto those in the world who are in darkness. Bless us, Lord, even now as we have a fellowship dinner. Bless the food to our bodies, strengthen and nourish us. Lord, just bless the remainder of our day that we might bring glory to your great name. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.